Welcome to Talks at GS. It is my great pleasure to interview today Barry Sonnenfeld, who's a legendary filmmaker. So Barry's out with this highly entertaining new memoir called Call Your Mother, Memoirs of a Neurotic Filmmaker. So let's start with the title of your book. So,
sure.
there's an opening story in the book which starts to describe your relationship with your parents. So would you tell us about the episode? It's 1970, Jimi Hendrix concert.
Right,
Madison Square Garden.
Right, so the book is called Barry Sonnenfeld, Call Your Mother. And in January of 69, it was the first peace concert at Madison Square Garden. Jimi Hendrix, Peter, Paul, and Mary, the cast of Hair. And I convinced my parents, who were very overprotective, to let me go to this concert with the understanding I had to be home at 2 a.m. All right, that's the setup. So 19,600 people at Madison Square Garden. It's 2:20 in the morning, and Jimi Hendrix is now on stage for the second time. He's tuning up his guitar. He's talking to the various members of his group. He gets ready to play the first chord, and over the PA system at 2:20 in the morning comes the following announcement: Barry Sonnenfeld, Call Your Mother. So let's break this down. First of all, for anyone to even find someone to answer the phone at Madison Square Garden is extraordinary.
It's a miracle.
At 2:20 in the morning. Second of all, to convince them that it's so important what's happening in my life that I should be paged is also pretty amazing. But my mother's philosophy in life was always strength through weakness. You know, if you're really weak, others will come to your defense and help you. And she managed to get someone to page me. So of course, once they announce Barry Sonnenfeld, Call Your Mother, and I stand up, everyone knows I am Barry Sonnenfeld. So that because it's a garden, you get that chant. Barry, Barry. Now I'm up in the cheap blue seats, but it's starting to move down towards the orange and red seats.
And you were on a date, right?
And I was on a date with Susan, who was also a senior at Music and Art High School. So now I'm weeping, because I know the only reason I'm being paged is because my father died. And it has a good ending, don't worry. And of course, because I'm an only child and my mother is horrible, the last thing I want to do is spend the rest of my life with my mother without a father, because he was kind of a co-conspirator, but a little protective. So now I get to the payphone, there are no cell phones, and I put in the dime, I call Wadsworth 86160, weeping uncontrollably. Hi, Mom. Who died? I thought you did. What do you mean you thought I did? Well, you said you'd be home at 2. It's 2:20. I said, did they tell you the concert was still going on? Yes, but they couldn't guarantee you were there. So Susan and I went home. And by the way, Jimmy stormed off. So, and 8 months later, he died of a suicide overdose. So I blame my mother.
Right, for his
death. Jimmy's
death. For his death.
Yeah.
So your mother and father didn't push you to be a lawyer or a doctor.
That's right.
Your mother wanted you to be an artist. Your father wanted you to do something you loved.
That's right.
And so how did you end up picking up a movie camera and becoming a filmmaker?
Well, you know, I think one of the few things my parents did right, although here I am, so I guess I did a few things right. But my mother wanted me to be an artist, but didn't specifically say what that meant. And my father said, figure out what will make you happy in life, and do that, and you'll find a way to make a living doing at it. What's interesting about that is my father was in Chapter 11 every 7 years. So he figured out what would make him happy in life, but never figured out how to make money doing it. So what happened was, I went to undergraduate school at NYU. They used to have a campus in the Bronx called University Heights. Hated it. It was like college day camp. There were no dorms. See, let's back up. My mother said, if I went to sleepaway school,
others, That's what I was thinking.
Others call it college. My mother called it sleepaway school. she would commit suicide. And don't tell your father that I said this. So I spent 3 years living in Washington Heights with my parents, sleeping in a Barca lounger because I had turned the area where my bed was into a dark room. So I spent 3 years at NYU and would only take political science courses because they, look at that, I fixed my tie, because they met Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday between 9 and 2. So I could take 30 credits a year at NYU and only go to school 3 days a week. The rest of the time I worked at the library at Lincoln Center, which was great. So I knew I wasn't going to be a political scientist when I grew up. So I was out of school a year, out of college a year. My senior year was at Hampshire College, which is a great, interesting place to go to college for a year.
But didn't you go to film school because you wanted to avoid the job market?
Yeah, so after a year of graduating NYU with nothing to do, my mother said, why don't you go to film school? You like to take photos, you like to write. Film is just a lot of still photos and words, which, by the way, it isn't. So I went to NYU for 3 years. She said they would pay for my education, which of course they didn't, so I took out all these student loans. So I had to pay back a lot of money, but when I graduated film school, I discovered I had an ability to shoot things. I really liked photography. So I bought a used 16 millimeter camera. Again, this is way before video. You guys don't know this, but there used to be something called 16 millimeter. But in any case, by owning a camera, I thought I could call myself a cameraman without being a dilettante. Yes, I'm a cameraman, I own a camera. I was shooting industrials for Rabbi Gelman and Sony Trinitron industrials and stuff like that. And one day I was at a party and everyone there was from Darien, Connecticut for some reason, except for one other Jewish guy across the room, and that other Jewish guy was Joel Cohen. Mm-hmm. We started to talk. He had written a script for Blood Simple with mm-hmm. his brother Ethan. And they were going to shoot a trailer. And this is a really good idea. They were going to shoot a trailer as if it was a finished movie. And by having this trailer, they could show it to dentists and doctors and other people that might invest. And because investors can't read a script and say, yeah, this will be good. Nor do they know if Joel and Ethan could direct, because they had never directed before. But by showing a trailer, you could say, yeah, this looks like a movie I would see. So Joel said they were going to shoot this trailer, and I said, I own a camera. And Joel said, you're hired. And we shot the trailer for Blood Simple. It took us a year to raise the $750,000, which, and every point was $15,000. And to this day, if you had invested $15,000, you probably would have made back $75,000 or $80,000 or $85,000, which is very unusual in the film business to actually get your money back, let alone make a profit. So the first day on the set of Blood Simple was the first day Joel, Ethan, or I had ever been on a movie set.
So tell us what else you learned on Blood Simple about what it means to be a filmmaker from a business standpoint in terms of making a film and the team you have to pull together. What did you learn in those early days?
Well, film is all about pre-production. What you learn is that you never want to get on a movie set and scratch your head and try to figure out where to put the camera. The worst thing in the world is to be on a movie set and look out the window and see the grips and electricians throwing frisbees or napping on sound blankets while you're trying to make a decision. So I think in life, whatever profession you're in, it's all about pre-production. What can go wrong? What can you do ahead of time to figure everything out? So for me, it's all about pre-production, mm-hmm. preparing for everything. And that's what we did. Every shot in Blood Simple, Raising Arizona, Miller's Crossing were all storyboarded, all designed within an inch of their life. On Blood Simple, we had a page for every shot and would write about effects or how we were going to cut it. So for me, it's always about being prepared for everything to go horribly wrong. And then when it goes wrong,
you're prepared.
Well, here's the great thing. It's why you want to be a pessimist in life. Kim, and here's why.
Okay, tell me.
If you're a pessimist, it's a win-win. If every time you get on a plane, you turn to your wife and say, this plane's gonna crash, one of two things happen. If it does start to spiral down, you get to turn to your wife and go, am I right? And if it doesn't crash, you live.
Right.
So the joy is pure pessimism.
That makes sense to me.
There's no upside to optimism. So that's what I learned shooting for the Coens.
So big.
Right.
So you desperately wanted to do this movie.
That's right.
Penny Marshall was the director.
That's right.
She did not think you were good or talented.
No.
And she didn't think Tom Hanks was either.
No.
So talk to us about that experience.
So I lived in East Hampton, Long Island for 30 years, and I wanted to really break into the New York world of camera work, you know? And Bobby Greenhut, who produced all the Woody Allen movies, was the New York guy, and he was producing Big. And I really, really wanted to be the cameraman on Big. Although when I was hired, Big was going to star Robert De Niro and not Tom Hanks.
Can you imagine?
I think it would have been equally good, because the thing about De Niro is he's really a man playing a boy. Hanks was like a boy playing a boy. You know, he was like 30-something. But for De Niro to do it, I would love to see that version, and I hope they do a remake with De Niro, who's now in his 70s. But in any case, I go in to meet Penny Marshall, and she's chain smoking, and she's backlit, and she explains to me all the things she wants to do with the camera on Big. When Tom is a kid, the camera should be naive and low to the ground, whatever naive means. When he's an adult, it should be more sophisticated and higher. Now, as a cameraman, I know it's never gonna work out that way. You know, sometimes you wanna be low angle, but wait, Tom's an adult, what do we do? So she went on, and she finished, and she said, well, what do you think? And I said, would it be okay if I just made it look nice? Which, by the way, few movies really succeed
in looking nice.
So she said, as it turns out, Greenhut, she said, nice would be good. And then Greenhut stood up and said, thank you very much. And I was ushered out. So I said 8 words in the interview. 6 weeks later, I still haven't gotten a call back, and I'm shooting one of the industrials for Sony Trinitron televisions. And I get a call from Bobby Greenhut, who said, you know, I was walking to work, and I realized we start shooting in 10 weeks. I still don't have a cameraman. Why don't I just hire that idiot Sonnenfeld, is what he said to me. So I said, I don't want to get hired as the idiot Sonnenfeld. He goes, I'm hiring you. I said, not as the idiot Sonnenfeld. He said, what do you want? I said, I want another interview so you can hire that really smart guy, Sonnenfeld. He goes, I'm hiring you. I said, I don't like your terms. He said, all right, come up, come back to the office. So I came back, elevator opens, there's Greenhut, and Greenhut says, I just got off the phone with the studio. They said, hire the cheapest cameraman you can find. I said, that I can do. So I got hired to shoot Big, but Penny's strength in comedy was a sort of physicality. You know, it was her idea to have the little baby corn that Hanks eats at the party, and she knew that if he had to eat caviar and didn't know what it was, he'd be disgusted by it. But she had no visual style in spite of her naive, sophisticated discussion, and she refused to make decisions. Hmm. And all of my entire reason for being is decision making. I always say to my daughter, she'd make a great director because she's opinionated and pushy. And that's all directing is answering questions and pretending you care about them. If the prop guy says, I got these two folders, you want the green one or the red one? They don't want to hear, oh, you choose, it doesn't matter. You have to choose, you say, I want the green one. And then on the day of shooting, you realize that the actress is in a green dress, and you can't see the folder because you said green folder. So you go to the prop guy and you say, hey, you remember when? And he goes, yeah, the red one's in the truck, I'll get it. So you're protected anyway, but it's all about making decisions, and Penny refused to make decisions. And I think Penny just didn't like me. At the end of the Monday of the second week, Monday morning, she's got her dozen White Castle hamburgers, 7 a.m., and a carton of Marlboros, and says to me, Monday of the second week, I tried to fire you, but they wouldn't let me. Who wouldn't let you, Penn? They wouldn't. I called Danny, because she was friends with Danny DeVito, and I had shot Throw Mama from the Train while we were waiting for Hanks. And she said, Danny says you're good, but I don't think so. And that's how we got through 12 weeks. But she was great. I had no problems with her not liking me. And she had no problems with not liking me either.
So let's talk about another legendary one, When Harry Met Sally.
Right.
A legendary scene in Katz's Deli.
Sure.
And Rob Reiner, I think, said it was the worst day of his life, or you said it was the worst day in his life?
No, Rob did. So
tell us about that.
Rob sweats a lot.
Oh.
You add that to the steam tables at Katz's Deli, so the humidity is 100%. It's hot because we've got all these movie lights. And Rob has decided to have his mother say, I'll have what she's having, after Meg fakes an orgasm. So Rob is not only directing Meg faking an orgasm in front of his mother, but is acting it out. So Rob is saying, no more like this. Right, and he was sweating so much, he got them to give him, got wardrobe to give him a towel, and he wore a towel over his head to absorb all the sweat coming off of his head, his bald head. But in any case, it was a terrible day for Rob. But here's an interesting thing about movies and that scene. And it's, if you ever want to direct, everyone thinks Meg is incredibly funny doing that scene. But if you're in the audience watching that scene, the laughter is here as Meg is faking it. Then you cut to Billy Crystal reacting, doing absolutely nothing. And the laughter goes from here to here. It's always about the reaction shot in comedy. It's why really, really good comedies don't have a lot of editing, but play out in two shots. So you can see action and reaction in the same shot. It's why His Girl Friday and Bringing Up Baby and all the Preston Sturges movies are so good, because they play them wide so you can see action and reaction in the same shot. I always say that close-ups are the enemy of comedy. Because a close-up, the director is saying, here, I'm cutting to that for the punchline. I want the audience to be smarter than me. I want them to figure out where the punchline is. It's why I always tell actors never to be funny in comedies. It's why you never want two funny people in your comedy. You need Tommy Lee Jones and you need Will Smith. You don't want two comedians. And in fact, in Wild Wild West, one of the reasons it wasn't better, and part of it was my fault as well, was we had Kevin Kline and Will Smith, two funny guys, in a comedy, and Will came, and I couldn't get Kevin to not be funny. And Will, I trained Will on the theory of no funny people in your comedy, and Will came up to me after a week and said, I gotta play the straight man, don't I? And I said, well, Kevin's not going to, so you're gonna have to. So Will and Kevin kind of reversed roles because I couldn't get Kevin to be the straight guy in that movie. There were other issues, yes, I know. Tone, Will in drag. That was not my idea, that was John Peters' idea. But in any case, one of the problems was you don't want two funny guys in your comedy, and you don't want Will Smith not being the funny one.
So your directorial debut was the
Addams Family, right.
And no other director wanted to take on this film? And
then, well,
is that the story?
No other good director.
No other good director wanted it.
I was not looking to be a cameraman. I was very happy with, I was not looking to be a director. I wasn't saying I could do a better job than Penny Marshall. I didn't say that. And I was finishing up shooting Misery for Rob Reiner, and I was in LA, and this will sound incongruous, but Sweetie and I were in bed watching the Indianapolis 500 auto race when my phone rang at the Four Seasons Hotel in LA, and the front desk said, Scott Rudin, who's a famous producer of both Broadway musicals and Broadway shows and films, has left you a script. He wants you to read it and in 2 hours meet him at Hugo's for lunch. So there was this script and it said, read it, I want you to be the director of Adam's Family. And I was a cameraman. So I read it and didn't like it, but I loved the Charles Adams drawings in the New Yorker and all that. I met Scott Rudin at Hugo's and I said, so what makes you think I can direct? Why me and why do you think I can direct? And he said, well, I gave it to Tim Burton and Terry Gilliam and they both passed. So all the good directors passed.
So I thought of you.
And he said, and I didn't want to just get like a comedy hack. I want to get someone who might fail but might do a really good job and can visualize these this into a visually stunning show. So I was the right guy because I loved the Charles Adams cartoons. And in fact, Rudin, and we went very over budget due to Scott and all this stuff, but in any case, Rudin every third or fourth day would have another director's chair with another famous director that he pretended passed. So by the end of the movie, there were 20 or 30 director's chairs with different comedy, you know, Penny Marshall, Howard Koch, whatever director was, he pretended passed. But we did Adam's Family. It was a big success. And in fact, Scott Rudin called me up the Sunday that we had come out, and we did twice the box office that was predicted. It was like a really big success. And Scott called me Sunday night and said, Barr, congratulations. And I said, well, you know, Scott, even if it hadn't done well, I still would have loved it. And, you know, the marketing people did a great job and the distribution. And he interrupted me and said, Barry, if you can't be happy tonight, your mother won. I said, wow, you're right. Okay, I'm happy. So for a day, I was happy.
And so did that lead directly or indirectly into Get Shorty?
No. After, again, same lesson. After Adam's Family. And by the way, first-time directors get scale. So I made a fifth the amount that I would have made if I had spent those 15 months as a cameraman. So I was broke. And Adam's Family came out and did really well, and I got asked to direct a movie that no one has seen, starring Michael J. Fox, called For Love or Money. And I did it because I really needed money, and it was the wrong thing to do. On the other hand, starving is bad, too. So. And then after that, I did Adam's Family Value. And here's a story that no one knows that I took out of the book because I thought it sounded snarky.
Oh, tell us.
So imagine this. Adam's Family Values was started at Orion Pictures. Orion is going bankrupt. They desperately need money, and halfway through the show, they sell us to Paramount Pictures. Frank Mancuso Jr. buys Adam's Family halfway finished, Friday morning. Friday afternoon, he's fired, having nothing to do with, you know, him buying Adam's Family. The new head of the studio comes in, Stanley Jaffe, sees the same 15 minutes we've cut together. And Stanley announces that our movie is uncuttable and unreleasable. So the next half of me finishing Adam's Family for Paramount, everyone hates the movie because Stanley says it's no good. But Stan Lee is like a meaner version of Mussolini or Dick Cheney. I mean, there's no comedy bone in his body, right? So now everyone's nervous. They won't let us have bottled water on the set because they're angry at it. I don't know. So we finished the movie, and the president of the company, not the chairman, Gary Lucchese, takes me to lunch and says, look, I know you have a director's cut. If you direct a movie, the DGA, Directors Guild of America, protects directors, and you have 10 weeks to cut the movie without the studio seeing it. Because that's how long it takes to just get it in some sort of order good enough to show the studio. So Gary says, I know you have 10 weeks, but show us the movie now. Don't wait for the 10 weeks. And I go, you know, Gar, I need the 10 weeks. He goes, come on, show me the movie. I go, no, I'm not going to show you the movie. And he says, if you won't show me the movie, will you at least tell me what it's like? Now they've seen the cut footage of the first half. They've seen dailies every single day. He says, tell me what it's like. And I go, I really shouldn't do this, but I'll tell you. It's like a much sadder version of Sophie's Choice. And I leave. Scott Rudin is calling me in my office saying, did you just, I told Gary it's a much sadder version of Sophie's Choice. Right, so Scott Rudin calls me up and says, did you just tell Lucchese that Adam's Family is a sadder version of Sophie's Choice? I said, no. He said, what did you tell him? I said, it's a much sadder version. I said, Gary believes you. Go call him up and tell him what it's like. Gary Lucchese, please. 1 minute. Hello? Hi, Gary, it's Barry. Hello, Barry. Listen, you know like when I told you that Adam's Family is like a much sadder version of Sophie's Choice? Yes. It was sort of a joke, Gary. Well, what's it really like? It's actually quite funny. Really? Really? That's fantastic. So he equally believed that it was funny as that it was a sadder version of Sophie's Choice. All right, so now the movie is done. Everyone loves the movie. And Gary says, look, we have these 8 drafts of a script. And none of the drafts are any good. So I'm going to give you the novel. I want you to read this novel and see if you want to direct it. And the novel is Forrest Gump. I read Forrest Gump, and I say, and it's about a fat guy who's really strong. It's not about a fast runner. It's about a fat guy who's really strong, not unlike Confederacy of Dunces in many ways. So I call Lucchese and go, look, I think we should change the idea to a guy running, that he's a really great runner. And if you want, I'll send it to Hanks, because Hanks and I became really good friends on Big. Mm-hmm. So he says, great. So I send Hanks the book, and I say, look, this might be too similar to Big, because it's sort of another man-child kind of thing. But if you're interested, let's do this. Hanks says, I love it. I'm hired to direct Forrest Gump. I hire Eric Roth. I've got Tom Hanks. We've got a script. And then Paramount decides to do Adam's Family Values. So now the head of the studio is a woman named Sherry Lansing. And I say to Sherry, I'll do Adam's Family Values only if you'll wait for me to do Forrest Gump. And she says, I'll wait for you. However, the producer, a woman named Wendy Feinerman, made the right choice. She said, I don't want to wait for Barry. What if Hanks dies? What if there's another movie that's too similar to Forrest Gump? And her husband at the time was Mark Canton, who was the head of Warner Brothers. So my agent calls me and says, you don't want to screw around with Mark Canton. He says, you'll never work in this town again. I've never heard that. And you should give up Gump so you can direct Adam's Family. And my mistake was that I should have said, I'll give it up, but I want a producing credit. Because mm-hmm. No one knows I actually hired Hanks and that it was my idea and all that stuff. So it's all fine. I couldn't see the movie. When it came out, I was decimated, as my mother would say. And I ran into Marty Brest at a party. And Marty looks like a rabbi. And I said, Marty, you've been on many films and you've been fired at the last minute or you've quit and they've gone on to be successful. How do you get through that emotionally? And Marty said, as if a rabbi, he said, have you seen the movie? And I said, no, I can't see the movie. And he said, see the movie, only then can the healing begin. And I went to see Gump and it was not the movie I would have made. I think mine would have been an hour shorter. It might have been better, it might have been worse, but it would have been different, and the healing began. So that's the story I took out of my book that you have heard today.
Okay, you have to tell us about Men in Black and Will Smith and that partnership and what that franchise means to you.
Well, I kind of think that Men in Black is sort of a documentary. You don't want to see me alone and tell your ride when my wife is not with me, because I have to walk the dog at night, and I know there's ghosts, aliens, supernatural stuff. So for me, that was like just like a documentary. So when I came on to Men in Black, Steven Spielberg, who is the executive producer, insisted that the Will Smith role, this is before, it's not written for a black guy or anything. Well, they wanted, okay, so Sweetie and I read the script. Sweetie always gives me a 60-page head start because I'm a slow reader and she's smart. We finish the two scripts, and I turn to Sweetie and go, Tommy Lee Jones, and she says to me, Will Smith, right? And Sony wanted Clint Eastwood and Chris O'Donnell. You don't even know who Chris O'Donnell is, but I think he's in like one of those NCIS things. And Spielberg says, Chris O'Donnell is in L.A. I want you to meet him and convince him to do Men in Black, to play the Will Smith role. I mean, no one has mentioned Will Smith except Sweetie. But I don't want Chris O'Donnell, I want Will Smith, because Sweetie told me Will Smith. So I go to dinner with Chris O'Donnell, and he says, look, here's the thing. I think the script needs work, and I've been offered this other movie. I think it was called Cliffhanger or something, I don't know. But I've been offered this other movie, so tell me more about Men in Black, so I can decide. And I said, well, here's the thing. Cliffhanger is going to be a really good movie because I think Stallone is in it, and he's really smart. He fired me off of a movie. When I was a cameraman, I was shooting a movie called Tango and Cash, and Stallone fired me off of it for good reason. on the other hand, Kurt Russell is fantastic. So I said, look, if you can work with Stallone, first of all, that's great. Second of all, the script has Men in Black has a lot of script problems, and I don't know how to solve them, and I don't think I'm a particularly good director. So the next day, Chris O'Donnell passed on Men in Black. I go back to East Hampton, where I live, and Spielberg spends the summers in East Hampton, and I know that Will Smith is going to be in Philly at a wedding, so I arrange for a helicopter to fly Will Smith from Philly to East Hampton to meet Spielberg. I make sure his kids are around so that they can say, Will Smith is really cool. Now, by the way, this is the only thing he had done in movies was 6 Degrees of Separation. Mm-hmm. This is before Independence Day or anything. But Sweetie told me, Will Smith. So Spielberg meets Will Smith, agrees to hire Will. At some point, I had so many disagreements with the producer on the show. I leave Men in Black because we finally get funding to do Get Shorty. I do Get Shorty. I hear that the person they hired to direct Men in Black has been fired. They haven't even started shooting yet. And I see the head of Sony having brunch with Uma Thurman at the Ivy at the Shore, and I go up to Barry Josephson, and I say, hey, listen, you know, I'm in post-production on Get Shorty. If you want me back, I've always loved Men in Black. I got rehired after quitting, and the rest is painful history.
You ended the book with something Will Smith told you about your own success.
Yes.
Can we end on that?
Yes. And this is very important for all of you guys. Will Smith said he wanted to take me around to all the schools in Philly and say, if this person can be a successful director on big budget movies, anyone can. And the last line of the book is, if I can be a successful director on big budget movies, anyone can.
Barry, thank you so much.
Thank you, Kim. What a pleasure.